رَبِّ اشْرَحْ لِي صَدْرِي وَيَسِّرْ لِي أَمْرِي وَاحْلُلْ عُقْدَةً مِّن لِّسَانِي يَفْقَهُوا قَوْلِي وَاللَّهُمَّ ثَبِّتْنَا عِندَ الْمَوْتِ بِلَا إِلَٰهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ وَاللَّهُمَّ اجْعَلْنَا مِنَ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ وَتَوَاصَوْا بِالْحَقِّ وَتَوَاصَوْا بِالصَّبْرِ آمين يَا رَبَّ الْعَالَمِينَ. In today's khutbah, I'd like to share with you some reflections from two ayat that belong to Surah Al-Baqarah. But before I talk about those ayat, I'd like to share some basic definitions with you and some concepts that are not often talked about. I have spoken about these things before, but not in this way. And like many of the ulama of our past and students of the Quran of the past, whenever they pass by ayat that they have studied before, Allah Azza wa Jalla even describes it himself, لَمْ يَخِرُّوا عَلَيْهَا صُمًّا وَعُمْيَانًا. They don't trip over them, you know, mute, you know, deaf and blind. What that means is they don't ever say, oh, I already know this. Like, you know, when you read some other book and you've already read it, you've read this chapter already, you say, I could skip this part because I already know this part, I'll go to another part. But that is just not the attitude of a believer towards the Quran. They go back to the same ayat that they've read hundreds, if not thousands of times, and Allah opens wisdom upon them, and He opens up guidance and counsel upon them. As even the Sahaba would experience this anew. Like, there are instances in the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam where, you know, the ayah was recited that was revealed a long time ago, but it was recited again, and Sahaba would say, I felt like it just came down. I felt like it was just revealed. So the idea of going back and reviewing and pondering again and, you know, engaging the book of Allah repeatedly and continuously is just one of the gifts that Allah has given this book. لَا تَنْقَضِي عَجَائِبُهُ. Its wonders don't ever cease. And that's hopefully a relationship you and I will always have the rest of our lives, that will keep going back to the book of Allah, and we will never underestimate what it has to offer. You and I will never think to ourselves, I already know the Fatiha. I can read something else now. I already know Baqarah. I already know this ayah. I already know this surah. I already know what it means. I've already read the translation. This kind of underestimating, you can do with any other book. You can't do it with the book of Allah. Because its wisdom is far beyond, even the wisdom of one ayah is far beyond what any one human being can fully internalize ever. In any case, what I wanted to share with you today was a basic distinction, a difference between two English terms first. And those two terms in English are a cult versus a community. A cult versus a community. And a cult, obviously, so those of you that are familiar with the term, is not a good word. It's an ancient word of the English language. Its origins from the 1600s, back in the day, it actually was used for worship itself. But in the modern usage of the word cult, it's used for a group of people that are cut off and they do their own weird ritual practices. You have devil worshipping cults, or you have heavy metal cults, or you have all these different kinds of groups, strange groups that are kind of on the fringes of society, and they form cults. But there are some things that I wanted to highlight that make a cult different from a community. Let's first talk about what they have in common. A cult is when a group of people come together, and a community is also when a group of people come together. So what makes them different? Here's the first of all differences. A cult sees itself as against the rest of the world. They want to see themselves as one thing, and everybody else is out to get them, and they are at war, if not physically, at least ideologically, with everyone else. So they are a closed group that is antagonistic and aggressive. As compared to that, a community is actually something that keeps its doors open all the time. A community actually wants to learn about other communities. Like Allah will say, لِتَعَارَفُوا, so you can get to know one another. It welcomes people from other communities, it opens doors, it makes cooperation happen, it does business with other communities, it has trade agreements and all kinds of things. So cults are closed and aggressive, and communities are open and welcoming. That's the first difference between the two. Another thing about a cult is that it wants uniformity. It wants everybody to be exactly the same. They should dress the same, they should look the same, they should talk the same, they should behave the same. And if you see even a little bit of variation, they'll catch you right away. You might get kicked out of the cult if you don't follow along. They are very, very specific about how you have to behave. Right? And in a community, you have, by opposite, in a community, you have diversity. You can have people that are dressed differently, that talk differently, that have different habits, you know, and that's fine. It's okay to have people of different backgrounds and different ethnicities and different languages and different eating habits. All of it's fine. But a cult, there's no tolerance for these kinds of things. You have to stick to this thing. And if you don't, then you're in trouble. You're going to get kicked out. And then from here, you get the next difference between these two. In the best way to keep people inside a cult is to scare them, and to make them feel guilty, or to instill anger in them towards others. Cults feed off of negative emotions. They need it.
They need to make you angry to stay in the cult. So they'll constantly curse some other group or some other community, and they'll fire you up against them, and that's how they stay together. Their anger keeps them united. Or they will guilt you for not being good enough a member of the cult. And they'll constantly shame you and guilt you, and that's how you can keep stay inside. On the flip side of it is a community, which actually, when people make a mistake, they don't shame them and guilt them, they help pick them up. And they say, well, you know, if I had fallen and I had made a mistake, my brother would be there for me. These families would be there for me. So they're there to support each other, not guilt each other. And a community thrives off of encouragement instead of building anger and hatred. Instead of building suspicion towards others, a community is supposed to build, you know, good relations, better understanding, giving each other benefit of the doubt, building trust among each other. These are the kinds of things that communities build. Then, of course, inside of a cult, there is absolutely no room for asking questions. You can't say, why do we do this way? How come we do that? Even, you know, some cults are religious, so you can't even ask, how come we pray this way? Or how come we believe this? You can't ask questions, because if you ask questions, you're basically going to get kicked out. You might lose your membership for asking. You just shut up and follow. That's what you got to do if you want to stay in the cult. On the other hand, you have a community where questions are welcome. If you don't understand something, ask. And you're not going to get in trouble for asking. We can have an open conversation. We can share ideas. There's room for suggestion. There's room for questioning and better understanding. And people are going to be at different levels. Nobody's going to be made to feel guilty because they don't know something or they don't understand something. That's the point of a community. And of course, then the last part that I wanted to share with you as a difference between cults and communities is that cults, they have habits. They form certain practices and they do them and they don't even know why they do them. Over time, they don't even know why they're doing it. But everybody's got to do it. Everybody's got to do it. And if you come along and say, maybe this is not the best practice. Maybe there's a better way of doing things. Have we even ever asked the question, why we do this stuff? Why are we following it like this? Because it's harming our next generation. It's harming our families. It's harming this or that or the other. When you raise these questions, you can get, you know, not only kicked out, you can become the enemy. You can be labeled and become the enemy. On the other hand, in a community, there's constantly open shura, there's constantly open suggestions. And if there are certain practices that used to be working 10 years ago, somebody comes along and says, this was pretty good 10 years ago, but I think we need a change. We need an update. So society has changed, times have changed, our needs have changed, and we need to adapt. And so a community is willing to do that. A cult is not willing to do that. A cult says, this is how we did things before, that's how we're going to do them now. Now you shut up. Unless you want to get kicked out. Now, I wanted to make this distinction between these two because a lot of times in churches, in synagogues, in temples, and even in masajid, in Muslim communities, we like to think of ourselves as a community, but more often than not, we turn these places into cults. And if not one cult, there are several cults within a community. One group getting together, aggressive towards everybody else. They're the ones that are right. Everybody else is wrong. There are, in the history of Islam, for example, is a diversity of fiqh. There's a diversity in the schools of thought. And you might belong to a particular school. If you come from some part of the world where there's a tradition and there's a heritage, the Malaysians have a several century heritage of the Shafi'i school of thought, for example. People from India, Pakistan, a good number of them, a huge majority of them are from the Hanafi school of thought, etc. So you come from a particular school of thought, but then you come with this idea that your school of thought is it, that's it. Anybody else who does anything else, I don't even know if they're actually real Muslims or not. This kind of thinking is cult thinking. This is not community thinking. This is not community thinking. So that's the first thing that I wanted to highlight. That cults, by the way, cults, the only way they survive, I told you, is negative. That's the only way they can survive. And when they see a community growing and diversity growing, they feel threatened because they want everybody to be like them. They want everybody to be in uniform. Exactly the same. So when they see that changing, they go on the attack. Cults will go on the attack. Now, this is within the religious framework, but there aren't just religious cults. I started with the example of masajid, but that's not the only place. Social circles form cults. You have people that aren't even religious. You know, there are families that come from a particular background. They have a certain socioeconomic class. When they have a party, all those same families are invited. Now at this place's house, not that one, when the iftar season is going to start soon. Now you're going to see the same faces over and over again. And that's a nice thing. These are all good things. But you know what happens sometimes within those circles? certain values are imposed. So if one of them, if all of them have a house and one of them has an apartment, then the one who has an apartment feels pressure. I feel left out of this circle unless I get into a mortgage, because I don't belong. I can't even invite them for iftar, because they'll look at, and just the way they look, just the way they look at the apartment and say, oh, okay, just two bedrooms, just that much. It'll eat me alive inside. That's a cult. Because you're putting pressure on this person to get into an economic transaction they can't afford. And they're feeling pressure even if nothing has been said to them. And they have to conform to a standard that doesn't even make sense for them. Every family has their own situation. Every family has their own background, their own problems. But you know what we do a lot of times? A lot of the pressure you put on yourself, and a lot of the pressure your family puts on you, and you put on your family, doesn't even have to do with you. It has to do with this cult pressure that's on you, and you don't want to lose membership from that cult. And as a result, you harm yourself, you harm your family. You know, all it produces is harm. It does nothing good. These kinds of cults are formed inside offices. You are the only Muslim in the office. Everybody goes and has, you know, goes to the happy hour or something, and they invite you every time, and you feel the pressure. And if you're not going to go, you're not going to be disgusted when the promotion comes. You have to play this game, and you have to join them in their rituals if you want to be part of this thing. And there's kind of a unspoken membership. And if you don't play along, you're not considered a member. You're not going to be considered an equal. And you have to get your hands dirty and lose some of your principles. This is what a cult is, not just in the setting of a masjid, in the setting of a family, but even in the setting of an office, in colleges, in neighborhoods. You know, you could see cult followings in neighborhoods where, you know, when Christmas season, one family will go out of their way and put Christmas lights. And the other family will say, oh yeah? Now we can't afford it, but I think I can take a loan and put better Christmas lights than them. And nobody knows why they're doing it. They have no idea. Their primary reason is, my neighbor did it, I have to defeat them. That's their primary reason. If you're in a neighborhood of Muslims and somebody did an iftar, somebody did a party, and you're like, oh yeah, I'm going to give a better party. And you're feeling competition. This is cult mentality that eats away at a community. It creates competition, antagonism. That's what it builds. And so what I wanted to get at, especially when it comes to our families and big decisions we have to make for our families, like marriage. A lot of times the reasons for choosing a partner, the reasons for building family ties, the reasons come from cults. They don't come from reason. They don't come from the idea of a community. This ummah, the basis for which this ummah was formed was taqwa. The basis for which these people are sitting together and I'm standing in front of you, the only basis for it is la ilaha illallah. That is it. That is it. The one figure that defines our, not our cult, but our culture and our community, is Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who had an incredible task in front of him. I mean, you have to understand, you know, we're not traditional people anymore. We live in modern times. Even if you're the most traditional, a lot of things you do are not traditional. But the Arabs of that time were extremely, extremely traditional people. Forget thinking about foreigners as different. They thought of the next tribe as aliens. They were so hung up within their own identities, and to take those people and to build ukhuwah between them, brotherhood between them, is an incredible thing. Aws and Khazraj in Medina, they themselves didn't get along. They themselves had fights, and they're Medina. Imagine them versus Makkah, the people of Makkah. You know, this was not something easy to overcome, but this kind of mentality has been there and will be there, and one of the functions of our deen, one of the purposes of our deen, is to destroy this kind of thinking. Now I want to share the ayat with you that, subhanAllah, in one description of the Day of Judgment, in one beautiful description of the Day of Judgment, Allah Azza wa Jalla gives us the value of these fake standards that so many people put on themselves because they want to belong to a particular cult. And they don't even realize they're suffering from it. Allah Azza wa Jalla describes the Day of Judgment, and one of the first remarkable things about this ayah is that it's set entirely in the past tense. It begins, إِذْ تَبَرَّأَ الَّذِينَ تُبِعُوا. When those who used to be followed, have set themselves apart. Tabarru in Arabic means, basically in simple English, I have nothing to do with you. I have no responsibility for what you have done. I don't know what you did. You go your way, mind your own business, I'll mind my own business. The ayah begins describing there were a group of people who used to be followed. And then when judgment day comes, they stand before Allah and they say, I have nothing to do with these followers. I don't care about it. I don't know who these people are. I don't care about them. Let me bring this a little closer to home. There are today musicians, actors, there are athletes, you know, and they'll come in commercials and they'll wear a certain brand of sneakers, or they'll put a certain kind of cologne on, and then the sales will go up as a result of their product placement. You understand? Or people will dress like them and talk like them and want to be like them. Do these people know their fans? No, they don't. And they don't even care. All they care about is money. They don't care about you. These screaming fans can go over to the guy who's singing the song and say, you speak to my heart, man. All he cares about is whether you paid for it. Did you download a bootleg or did you pay for it? That's all he cares about. He doesn't care about whether you spoke to your heart or not. That's not what it's about. So on Judgment Day, that'll become very clear. All the people that we followed, all the people that set these standards for us, that influenced the way we're going to speak, the way we're going to dress, the way we're going to live, the way we're going to conduct our families, all of it, all of those things are going to fall apart, and those people will say, I have nothing to do with you. You know, for those of you that speak Urdu, one of this ayah, you'll understand it when you understand this one phrase, log kya kahenge? What are people going to say? You know those people that you're so worried about what they're going to say? When you're about to make a decision, let's do the nikah in the masjid. No, what are people going to say? We have to get a hall. No, let's just get this car. No, we have to get a newer car. What are people going to say? Let's get an apartment. No, we have to get a big house. What are people going to say? What are people going to say is like your qa'ida kulliya. It's the principle that defines your life. And it is those very people that stand on Judgment Day and say, I have nothing to do with these guys. Whether I say or not, I don't care about them. إِذْ تَبَرَّأَ الَّذِينَ تُبِعُوا مِنَ الَّذِينَ تَبَعُوا. They'll cut themselves off from those who used to follow them. Allah mentioned it in the past tense for a particular reason. Many of them, I'll share one of them with you. You have to imagine the next time you're following someone mindlessly, you have to imagine that this separation has already happened as far as Allah is concerned. Not even it will happen, it's already happened. These are the same people that are going to be saying they don't care a dime's worth about you. They don't care anything about you. وَتَقَطَّعَتْ بِهِمْ. So Allah says, وَرَأَوْا الْعَذَابِ. And they'll all be looking at the punishment. We will do wrong deeds because we follow people like this. We will do wrong deeds because we follow trends. Because we belong in cults mindlessly. And then punishment will come not just to those who were trendsetters, but also to the followers. They're both stuck in the pit. وَرَأَوْا الْعَذَابِ. وَتَقَطَّعَتْ بِهِمُ الْأَسْبَابِ. What a remarkable phrase in the ayah. And all of the asbab, I won't translate asbab yet, all of the asbab will be cut. Now what in the world is asbab? One of the meanings originally in the Arabic language, as-sabu al-habl, it's a rope. The ropes will be cut. It is as though you felt like you're tied to these people with a rope, and Allah will chop all those ropes up. All of them will be severed, like you have no connection with them. Others say, لَمْ يَجِدُوا إِلَىٰ تَخْلِيصِ أَنفُسِهِمْ وَأَتْبَعِهِمْ سَبَبًا. Like Imam Razi says. That they are not, sabab also means. Judgment day will come and they will have no way of saving themselves because the people they should have connected themselves to, they didn't. And the people that they shouldn't have connected themselves to, they were blindly following. So now they have no way of getting out of trouble. وَتَقَطَّعَتْ بِهِمُ الْأَسْبَابِ أَنَّهَا الْمُوَاصَلَاتَ الَّتِي كَانُوا يَتَوَاصَلُونَ عَلَيْهَا. It's also said that asbab are the relationships that they used to have that were built on fake things. There are relationships that are real, like ulul arham, family relations. There are relationships that are built on sincerity, people actually caring about you. And then there are relationships that are just fake social acquaintances, and you just want to impress them, and they just want to impress you, and nobody knows why they're doing anything. Those are the kinds of relationships that are just going to get chopped up. They will have no value whatsoever. Al-manazil allati kanat lahum fi dunya. Asbab also means status. Subhanallah. The status that they used to have. Judgment day will come. So many things people do for status. So many things people do for reputation. So many decisions we make for that. I met an accounting student not too long ago who said, I asked him, what's your major? He said, accounting. I said, where are you going to school? I'm going to this school. What's the tuition? 40,000 a year. I said, so after 4 years, you're going to owe 160,000? Yeah, on top of that student loan interest, all this stuff. I was like, after 4 years, you have a bachelor's degree. Are you going to be a CPA? No, that's another 2 years. What's the fee for that? About 75,000 a year. Okay, that's another 150,000 on top of that. So now you're in debt about $500,000 already, and you haven't even gotten a job yet. And who's going to pay you a high-paying salary by the time you come out of accounting school and hire you in a high, you know? And even if you do get paid a lot of money, you can't even start your life because you're still paying off debts from the school you went to. That's just bad accounting, bro. Why are you going to that school? Well, it's a pretty reputable school. And reputable in whose eyes? I don't understand. This is a person who understands accounting, except when it applies to themselves. Because status, image, that took over and their mind got shut off. They couldn't think anything straight. And the only concern was, well, if I go to a community college or if I go to a city school or if I go to, what are people going to say? What are my parents going to say? Nobody cares. No, when the time will come, nobody will care. You have to make sound decisions in your life, financial decisions, religious decisions, family decisions, and you have to let go of these unreasonable pressures that you put on yourself, because those people will not care about you when the time comes, especially when judgment day comes. And so asbabun najat has also been said, that any way of them being saved is going to be cut. Then there's no way to save yourself. People worry so much. They have so much depression, so much stress, because they have to keep up, like the American phrase, keeping up with the Joneses, right? You're this old, you have to have this much money, you have to have this much status, you have to have this much, this position. None of this should matter. Especially when it comes to your own personal life, make the right choices, make the right decisions, and don't let fake pressure from others come onto you. Even, I'll end where I started, within the religious community. Within religious communities, when cults are formed, then people are made to feel guilty because they, over things that even Allah's Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the Book of Allah never condemned, and they're being condemned. It's not even wrong, but in that cult it's wrong. In that cult it's unacceptable, you know? We create uniforms. We create uniformity in the way people have to look and behave. Even in things in which the deen always had diversity. There was always multiple ways of looking at it, but no, is this way or no way at all. This way or no way at all. And this is the kind of thing that makes people run. Because when someone comes out of a cult, they never want to go back. When they're in it, they're hypnotized. But when they run away from a cult, they look back and they get scared. Man, I don't want to go back into that crazy stuff again. So when people get burnt out, religiously burnt out because of cult behavior, and they run away from Islam, it's very hard to bring them back. Because they think of all of the religion, not as a community, now as a cult. And that's our fault. That we didn't understand the openness and the vastness of our deen, the mercy of our deen, the forgiveness of our deen, the positive nature of our deen, and we turned it into something ugly for people. May Allah Azza wa Jal forgive our shortcomings. وَقَالَ الَّذِينَ تَبَعُوا I end with this. وَقَالَ الَّذِينَ تَبَعُوا لَوْ أَنَّ لَنَا كَرَّةً فَنَتَبَرَّأَ مِنْهُمْ كَمَا تَبَرَّأُوا مِنَّا The people who used to follow them, the fan base, the people who did end up in those cults, now they're talking and they're saying, لَوْ أَنَّ لَنَا كَرَّةً If we only had another chance, if we only got to go back again, فَنَتَبَرَّأَ مِنْهُمْ كَمَا تَبَرَّأُوا مِنَّا Then we will cut ourselves off from them the same way they're cutting themselves off from us. وَالْفَاءُ لِلْمُفَاجَأَ Immediately, I won't even think about it. I won't even consider it. If I were to go back, I wouldn't even look towards that guy. That same person who influenced so many of my decisions. That same cult that dictated so much of my behavior will mean nothing to me. I will want nothing to do with them the way they've cut themselves off from me now. And Allah says then, كَذَلِكَ يُرِيهِمُ اللَّهُ أَعْمَالَهُمْ حَسَرَاتٍ عَلَيْهِمْ That is how Allah will show them their behavior. Now, this is what's called hal. حَسْرَةً عَلَيْهِمْ But Allah said, حَسَرَاتٍ عَلَيْهِمْ Regrets on top of regrets, on top of regrets, on top of regrets is what Allah is going to show them. They're going to think back and say, man, I made that horrible decision because of this. I made this other horrible decision because of this. They're going to make a list in their head of all the horrible decisions they made based on this unreasonable pressure that they put on themselves. And one hasra, one regret, on top of regret, on top of regret. And that's part of the pain of Judgment Day. You don't think of hellfire and judgment day as physical pain only. It's emotional pain. It's just looking over back at your life and saying, why did I do this? How could I do this? How did I live my life like this? One decision after another. حَسَرَاتٍ عَلَيْهِمْ وَمَا هُمْ بِخَارِجِينَ مِنَ النَّارِ. And they're not going to be the ones coming out of the fire. May Allah make us not of those of the fire. May Allah Azza wa Jalla enter all of us without any punishment into His Jannah. بارك الله لي ولكم في القرآن الحكيم ونفعني وإياكم بالآيات والذكر الحكيم. الحمد لله وكفى والصلاة والسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى خصوصا على أفضلهم وخاتم النبيين محمد الأمين وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. يقول الله عز وجل في كتابه الكريم بعد أن أقول أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم في العالمين إنك حميد مجيد. اللهم بارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم في العالمين إنك حميد مجيد. عباد الله رحمكم الله اتقوا الله إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر ولذكر الله أكبر والله يعلم ما تصنعون. أقم الصلاة إن الصلاة كانت على المؤمنين كتابا موقوتا.